Oh, the shark has pretty teeth, dear.
A gangster in the family. Hello there. I delivered this lecture at the Welsh Festival in Minneapolis 6 years ago, but this is a rolling story. It moves on as more detail becomes known. I salute Ninai on using this format at a time when COVID-19 is causing so much grief on both sides of the Atlantic. I hope that the North America Welsh community come out of this difficult time intact, keeping the Welsh dragon flying proudly on your side of the pond. We have a saying in Wales that you can choose your friends, but have to accept your family. If you're in professional politics, as I was, you may well shudder if it's alleged that you're a relative of a notorious gangster. So I beat the tabloid papers and got in my retaliation first, or at least my interpretation of a quite remarkable saga. In this lecture, I focus on a third cousin of mine, who was indeed a gangster. His name, Llewelyn Morris Humphreys, known by the nickname in Chicago 60 years ago, Murray the Hump. The family link is on my father's side, the Wigleys, who come from the hillsides above Llanidloes in Montgomeryshire, mid Wales. I was lucky to have inherited a detailed family tree on my father's side, going back centuries. I decided on retiring from elected politics to identify all the descendants of my great-great-grandfather, Joshua Wigley, born in 1768. They have scattered to the four winds. Many have emigrated to the United States. And amongst these were three Wigley brothers, my grandfather's first cousins, who moved to Minnesota in 1857. One of them, Richard Wigley, was elected to the Minnesota legislature in 1884. And indeed, so was his great-grandson, Dick Wigley, in 1971. This side of the family made a positive contribution to American public life, unlike the subject of this presentation. I knew absolutely nothing about Llewelyn Humphreys until a decade after his death. In 1976, Welsh television celebrated the bicentenary of American independence with a series about the Welsh in America. One focused on Chicago and gave worthy space to Frank Lloyd Wright, the famous American architect of Welsh descent. Sorry, he wasn't related to me. The second half of the program opened with the words, "For every good one, there's a bad one. And in this case, it's a very bad one indeed, Llewelyn Morris Humphreys." The program explained that Humphreys was one of Chicago's prominent gangsters, becoming a mob leader after Al Capone had been locked up. The shock for my family came when the program explained that Llewelyn's mother was Anne Wigley, who was born in 1866, just over the field from where my father was born 50 years later. As a result of this startling discovery, I started to explore the family link. Anne Wigley's father was a first cousin of my grandfather, so Anne was a second cousin of my father, and consequently, Llewelyn was my third cousin. So what exactly were the activities that raised Humphreys to be the doyen of Chicago's gangsters? Part of the saga has been described in John Morgan's book, published in 1985, No Gangster More Bold. Much more has become public since its publication, through books like The Outfit by Gus Russo. It's a book described as one of the essential works on the subject of organized crime in America, and has a subtitle, The Role of Chicago's Underworld in Shaping Modern America. Its index contains no fewer than 185 references to Humphreys' role in the development of organized crime across America. This compares to just 114 references to Joe Ocado, 110 to Sam Giancana, and only 73 mentions of Al Capone. I shall sum up Humphreys' activities by three bullet points which exemplify the enormity of his role in the world of American organized crime, I feel he would appreciate his life being summed up in bullet points. After Al Capone had been imprisoned, the title of Public Enemy Number One was attached by Chicago police to Humphreys, who was then just 34 years old. For the subsequent quarter century, he was widely described as the brains behind the mob. And when Bobby Kennedy was appointed counsel to the House Rackets Committee in 1958, he named five gangsters as leaders of America's organized crime, and head of that wanted list was Humphreys himself. Let me give you a bit more about the family background. His parents, Brian Humphreys and Anne Wigley, were married in 1888 in Llanidloes, Montgomeryshire. And by 1889, they had set up home in Racine, Wisconsin. Anne had given birth to two children in Wales before she married Brian. Almost certainly, Brian was father of both. The older, Thomas Charles Wigley, was brought up by a foster family in the Rhondda Valley in Wales. The younger of the two, Ethel, born in 1888, went with them to America. Brian and Anne remained in Racine for some 18 months. They settled into a Welsh-speaking community and lived just a stone's throw from one of the two Welsh chapels in the town. Brian had a job in a local factory, as recorded in the Racine Directory of 1890. So the key question is, why did they move to Chicago? In all probability, this was because the Welsh community in Racine was too respectable. Too respectable for Brian, certainly. He liked his liquor and his gambling. They could escape the critical eye of fellow Welshmen and women if they disappeared into the bowels of the Windy City. They drifted from area to area in Chicago, eventually settling in Prairie Avenue, a respectable part of the city, where Brian got a job as a coachman to William Gray, one of the leather tycoons of Chicago. That's where Llewellyn Morris Humphreys was born in 1899, fourth of five surviving children. He was called Morris by the family, but Llewellyn to the outside world. He adopted the name Murray as a teenager. He was named after Brian's brother Llewellyn, who remained in Montgomeryshire, and Brian's other brother, John, was a respected lawyer who also stayed in Wales. Llewellyn initially attended Haven School, where Chicago's elite sent their children. But in 1906, with Llewellyn just 7 years old, disaster struck. His father, Brian, lost his job because of his drinking. They had to leave Prairie Avenue and move to South Michigan Avenue on the tough side of the city. Brian never again held any permanent job, and the family lived in poverty. This change was totally disruptive for their children. Llewellyn left school at the age of seven to sell newspapers on the street corners and joined a gang for protection. He got associated with Chicago's worst elements and was involved in constant fights. Llewellyn also got into trouble by way of petty larceny, but nothing too serious until he was some 15 years old. He was then arrested for a major theft. And this episode shows that from an early age, he was quite a standout character. He asked at the police station if he could discuss his case with the city's chief prosecutor. The police surprisingly agreed. Llewellyn told the prosecutor that if he was found guilty of the full charges, he would almost certainly face a long prison term. To avoid that, he would appear in court in his Sunday best suit, would describe how his family's poverty had driven him into crime, would break down in tears, and to avoid giving him a lengthy sentence, the court might well find him not guilty. However, said Llewellyn, if the prosecutor only charged him with a lesser crime, carrying a shorter period of corrective training, he would plead guilty. The prosecutor would then be praised for solving the case, and in addition, he would receive a valuable little present. The prosecutor wasn't stupid. The lesser charge was preferred. Llewellyn pleaded guilty and was given a short corrective sentence. The next day, the prosecutor received a plain envelope containing a diamond-studded watch, reflecting Llewellyn's appreciation of his kindness. Llewellyn subsequently evolved into a serious gangster. Perhaps because of a Welsh link, who knows, he teamed up with a corrupt accountant called Fred Evans, who dealt in stolen property. Evans taught him about laundering stolen cash, which was very useful as Humphreys's speciality at that time was kidnapping people for cash ransoms. Prohibition led to massive surges in crime in the 20s, and Humphreys saw the opportunity of hijacking illegal alcohol. One day, he hijacked a lorry belonging to Al Capone's syndicate. Humphreys threatened to kill the driver, who fled for his life. Alas, the driver had recognized Humphreys, and he told his boss, and Mr. Capone wasn't best pleased. Humphreys was captured. Normally, he would have been instantly shot. No one crossed Al Capone. Humphreys asked if he could speak directly with Capone, who, remarkably, agreed to hear this insolent upstart. This was a ploy, of course, similar to that with the city prosecutor a decade earlier. Capone soon saw that he was no ordinary hoodlum. He gave Humphreys a choice of being shot or to join Capone's syndicate. Now, Humphreys wasn't dumb, and he accepted the proposed apprenticeship, starting as a trainee driver of illegal alcohol. The rest, as they say, is history, which I'll briefly summarise now. Humphreys took centre stage in the process of corrupting the judiciary. He learnt about the law from a certain Judge Murray, possibly Judge Jack Murray, who supervised his juvenile correction training order, and seeing his potential, taught him about the law. In his honour, Llewellyn changed his name to Murray Humphreys. In 1929, Murray Humphreys planned the St. Valentine's Day massacre, when seven of Al Capone's main gangster rivals were shot in a garage in North Clark Street, close to where Humphreys lived as a child. Humphreys organised a system of money laundering. He literally set up, with Fred Evans, a network of laundries, businesses receiving cash from genuine customers and from illegal sources alike. So dirty money from crooked operations came out as clean revenue from the laundry's work. Later, Humphreys did this on an industrial scale, taking over legitimate companies solely to feed mob money through their books. Humphreys' main tool for sucking money out of businesses' corporations was via labour unions. He would ensure mob nominees ran the unions, both locally and later, nationally. In his heyday, Humphreys had direct personal control over a staggering 62 unions across America. He used this union power to corrupt whole sectors of the economy, such as Hollywood's film industry between 1934 and 1941. The bosses of Warner Brothers, Paramount, and 20th Century Fox had to pay protection money to the gangsters or face crippling strikes. Humphreys was partly responsible for creating Las Vegas as the gambling capital of America from 1947 onwards. He did this by bribing Nevada state legislators to change the law to allow gambling. He became joint owner of one of the largest casino hotels, the Tropicana. To frustrate the courts, Humphreys formulated the Fifth Amendment plea, namely, "I refuse to testify on the grounds that it may tend to incriminate me." Dozens of crooks used this to avoid punishment. So proud was Humphreys of this law-beating ploy that he had the words engraved in wood above his bed. He devised a means of wiping the slate clean of all state charges against himself and fellow hoodlums by a masterly abuse of the double jeopardy rule. This was probably his most daring and successful escapade. Murray Humphreys planted his own people into key jobs in the police and law enforcement services. He also established a tight grip over key politicians in Chicago, on Illinois state legislature, and indeed in Washington. He had a detailed knowledge of the law and of taxation, and he advised the mob how not to pay too much tax while avoiding Capone's fate, who of course was imprisoned for not paying enough. Humphreys was chief strategist of the mob, succeeding his mentor, Johnny Torrio, who created the US crime map with 23 families forming the Crime Commission. Humphreys linked up with gangsters in New York like Mayor Lansky, in Los Angeles, Las Vegas, Boston, Detroit, Miami, Kansas, and New Orleans to roll out this crime network across America. That's why Bobby Kennedy made him number one target. Humphreys had long-standing tensions with the Kennedys. In the 20s, before he was even 30 years old, he had clashed with Joe Kennedy, the father of John and Bobby, who was close to the criminal world himself. Joe Kennedy had a monopoly for the importation of Hague whiskey, and Kennedy suffered a huge loss when a consignment was hijacked in Boston in 1927. Joe Kennedy tried to recoup his losses by setting up an alcohol business in Detroit and ignoring the fact that the Purple Gang already controlled Detroit's bootlegging. A contract to kill Kennedy was taken out by the Purple Gang. He was terrified and asked how the contract might be lifted, and he was told that only one person could do that, Murray Humphreys. Kennedy went to Humphreys, went to him for help. They came to an understanding, and the contract was indeed lifted. But Kennedy reneged on the deal, and from there on in, Humphreys and the Kennedys were at war, a consideration to which I shall return later. But before digging further into Humphreys' criminal activities, perhaps I should say more about his Welsh background. The press invariably refer to him as the Welshman Humphreys, something he probably cultivated to avoid being branded as Irish or Jewish or Italian. His Welsh awareness was evident when he named his only child Llewella, although, like so much else, it was corrupted into Luella. Welsh was the first language of his parents and the home language. He referred to them, to his daughter, as Nain and Taid. Welsh phrases such as Mochyn Bidyr would easily trip over his tongue, and he desperately wanted to visit Wales, but only made it once in the 1960s. He loved to make cine films, and one showed his parents, Anne and Brian, and other relatives, celebrating a traditional Welsh Christmas. He insisted that Llewella said her prayers at bedtime, and he arranged that she had a good musical education, and turned every stone to ensure that she met the leading musical stars of that age. Indeed, at her graduation party, the guest star was Frank Sinatra. Some have speculated that Llewella was adopted. He and his wife had no other children, and there are no photographs of Llewella as a baby. A relative of his wife suggested to me that Llewella was the daughter of his wife's unmarried sister from a liaison with another gangster. It's also doubtful whether Llewella actually married Rosanna Bratzi, the star of the musical film South Pacific, and who was father of George, Llewella's only child. The relationship didn't last, but Llewella adopted the name Brady, an anglicization of Bratzi, and it's as Llewella Brady that she's buried in Colorado. Llewella was close to her father and witnessed aspects of his corrupt life, as seen in a revealing episode from the 1952 American presidential election. General Eisenhower was the Republican candidate and Adlai Stevenson stood for the Democrats. And before the campaign started, there was a top-level meeting at the Humphreys' home. The mob leaders were all there to decide which candidate to back with their cash. The mob traditionally backed the Democrats, but Stevenson had misused mob money. Llewella took in the drinks, and her father asked her, "Say, kid, what do you think of Dwight D. Eisenhower?" She replied, "Gee, Dad, I'd vote for him if I could to be the next president." At which point, a voice spoke from behind her. "Why, thank you very much, young lady." She turned round to see who had spoken. And who was it but Eisenhower in person? The presidential candidate himself had to negotiate with the mob. Humphreys was a player on the national stage. I never spoke to Llewella, though I met her once. That strange episode was in the 1980s, when she was in London on her way to Wales to film with HTV. When I arrived in Parliament that morning, there was an urgent message saying that Llewella was in Westminster Hospital, and HTV asked if I could call to see her and to determine how ill she really was. So off I went to the hospital with some flowers, a little red dragon flag, and a get-well card. I was allowed to see her, but she was unconscious, so I never actually spoke to her. It was suggested that she'd taken an overdose the previous night, and according to the hospital authorities, so had her boyfriend done exactly the same thing and was unconscious in the men's ward. How very, very strange. When she later awoke, Llewella insisted on leaving hospital immediately, dragging her semi-conscious boyfriend with her. She got a cab to Heathrow Airport and a flight to Switzerland, ditching her filming plans in Wales. Apparently, the Humphreys fortune was, perhaps still is, stashed away in a bank in Switzerland. Perhaps someone was aware of Luella's plans, after visiting Wales, of going to Switzerland to take out her annual $1 million allowance. Had she been bumped off in London so that someone could impersonate her and pick up the cash? But back to Murray Humphreys. He spent very little time in prison. The only occasion he was incarcerated for a significant period was back in 1933. It was a bizarre charge that he hadn't paid tax on a ransom for a kidnap for which he hadn't even been found guilty of undertaking. He wasn't impressed, and he scarpered with his very able, college-educated wife, Clemmy, to Mexico to enjoy a delayed honeymoon of almost a year. He used the time to develop a strategy for reforming the old Capone syndicate into a new outfit which could flourish after Prohibition ended. When he was ready, he contacted the authorities in the States, agreeing to return and face the court, provided that it was a lesser charge that was brought against him and the more serious charges dropped, again reminiscent of his teenage ploy with the Chicago chief prosecutor. He imposed another condition, that similar charges be dropped against his fellow gangsters, something to which the authorities surprisingly agreed. The way Humphreys repeatedly got his cronies off the hook earned him loyalty from his underground colleagues as a real stand-up guy. Clearly, in Chicago, there is honour amongst thieves. His popularity amongst the Chicago mob also grew from the way he helped the outfit's small fry gangsters when they came out of prison. He would ensure that there was a house and a job available for them, however crooked that work opportunity might turn out to be. He set up a scheme to help families of gangsters in prison and the widows of those killed. He arranged a pension of $30,000 a year for one widow, acting as a fund trustee for her. These were amongst the reasons why no one in the outfit wanted to bump him off. He was too valuable an asset for them. After giving himself up, he spent a year in jail. While locked up, he asked to have lessons in English and maths, reflecting, I suppose, a Welshman's love for education. Another reason why he volunteered to serve his prison sentence was that he could slip out of the limelight. He wasn't happy at all being branded public enemy number one by the Chicago police. It was bad for business. He never aspired to be the big shot. And in his absence, he promoted Frank Nitti and Paul Rieker as the public faces of Chicago's gangsters, arranging for himself to be just a member of a seven-man board, which was designated to run the outfit. He took responsibility for strategy and finance, industrial policy, i.e. corrupting the labour unions, for fixing the courts, the police and the politicians, and for the welfare of gangster families. He pulled the levers, but he didn't dominate the stage. It's said that by the 1950s, Humphreys' activities across the states was netting over $600 million a year for the Chicago outfit. Humphreys was, throughout the period, the power in the background. Apparently, the character Tom Hagen, the consigliere in the film The Godfather, was partly based on Murray Humphreys' role as the elder statesman of the mob. His greatest victory over the authorities, on behalf of his fellow gangsters, was the bartender's trial of 1940. His brass-faced cheek, daring, and knowledge of the law led to a dramatic court victory over the law enforcing authorities. The background to the case was that a man called George McLean, who'd worked for 20 years for the Bartenders Union, had accused the outfit of interfering in the activities of the union and of stealing its funds, activities in which Humphreys had specialised, as McLean well knew. So instead of bringing charges against the riffraff that Humphreys had planted into the key union jobs, McLean named Humphreys and Frank Nitti in his charges. When the case came before the courts, the authorities were convinced that they had, at last, nailed Humphreys. He had given them the impression, when they questioned him, that he accepted that he had no chance of winning the case and was resigned to years in prison. So confident was the prosecution that they threw in many of the charges which they had on file against Humphreys and his cronies, turning it into a huge show trial. Humphreys appeared resigned that the trial would go ahead. He almost seemed to urge the authorities to get it done and to face the consequences. In the preliminary hearing, the prosecution had everything their own way, as if Humphreys and his defending lawyers could put up no defence whatsoever. So formal indictments were placed against Humphreys, Nitti, and Chicago's other main gangster leaders, and the case was scheduled to be heard in Chicago's main criminal court. When the appointed day arrived, the court was jam-packed with every news reporter, waiting to see the gangsters finally brought to justice. The defence case depended on the evidence of one person, George McLean. Without his original evidence, no case would have been brought to the court. Normally, the mobsters would threaten key witnesses to keep their mouths shut, or they'd be dead. No one could figure out why that hadn't happened on this occasion, until the main hearing opened. On the big day, McLean was asked his name, his address and age, to which he duly replied. Everything seemed to be progressing well for the prosecution. Yet Humphreys was sitting in the dock, totally relaxed. Then they saw why. When asked to give his wife's name, McLean responded, "I must refuse to answer on the ground that it might tend to incriminate me." The words of Humphreys's Fifth Amendment plea. McLean answered every single question with the same words, so the case collapsed. But as the charges against the defendants had been formally placed in open court, that court was obliged to pass a verdict on the defendants. They had no choice but to file not guilty verdicts on the grounds of lack of evidence. Clearly, McLean had been scared out of his wits. So why had Humphreys allowed him to testify in the earlier hearing before turning the screw on him? The answer is simple. By forcing a court to return not guilty verdicts under America's double jeopardy laws, it was impossible to bring the same charges against the same person a second time. So never again could those charges be filed against Humphreys, Nitti, and their associates. Humphreys, by his knowledge of the law and mind-blowing boldness, had wiped the slate clean. This gave the title to the book, No Gangster More Bold. The word spread through the criminal fraternity that Humphreys was too clever for the courts, and that no one could lay a finger on him. A decade later, Humphreys again ran rings around those trying to nail him, but in a very, very different way. In the 1950s, a grand jury was established in Chicago to investigate organized crime, and they persuaded Humphreys somehow to appear before them as a witness. He turned up without shaving, in a dirty raincoat, with a patch over one eye, leaning heavily on a walking stick and shaking profoundly. Answering questions, he mumbled incomprehensibly. He was told to go. The jury didn't believe that such a duffer could be the mastermind of the mob. Outside the court, he threw away the eye patch, walking stick, and scruffy coat and celebrated in the downtown bars, a performance worthy of an Oscar. Another time, before a congressional committee in Washington, Humphreys orchestrated the defense for 50 leading gangsters. He helped ensure that all but three got away scot-free. The senators couldn't fathom why they were walking away unblemished. Then Humphreys himself appeared as the final witness and ran rings around the committee, leaving them speechless. Congress, however, wasn't going to tolerate being made to look fools. Another congressional committee was called. This time they got their act together, and many of the gangsters were nailed. But when the hearing opened, to everyone's surprise, Humphreys' name had been removed from the list of those summoned to testify. The reason? Half a dozen police officers from Chicago, required to serve Humphreys with the summons, all testified that Humphreys was dead. Humphreys had bribed the police to spread the story about his death, and he escaped having to testify. Humphreys has been called the Brainy Hood, the Einstein of the mob, and the gentleman gangster. He was indeed a different breed of criminal. He even exhibited some salutary principles. While he had no scruples about killing criminals, given the choice, he preferred other methods. He refused to be involved with prostitution or narcotics, and he only drank in moderation. He warned fellow hoodlums not to flaunt their wealth, and himself lived in a modest house in a Chicago suburb. Someone who knew Humphreys well was FBI agent William Romer, appointed to break the grip of organized crime in Chicago. Romer spent a decade trying to nail Humphreys. In his book, Man Against the Mob, Romer describes their relationship. Soon after Romer arrived in Chicago, Humphreys asked to meet him to discuss ground rules for the police and gangsters' relationship. Neither side should threaten or punish their opponent's wives, girlfriends, or children. Innocent people shouldn't get hurt. It was like a Geneva Convention for gang warfare. After Humphreys' death in 1965, Romer attended the family lunch which followed the service and sympathized with his widow, with Luella and her young son George. In his book, Romer writes, "I told them how much I respected their husband, father, and grandfather. Then I put my hand on George's shoulder and told him that he could always remember his grandfather with respect. He was a fine man. In many ways, I meant it. The man had killed on the way up. He had committed my cardinal sin, corruption, many times over. But there was a style about the way he conducted himself. His word was his bond. I surely was to miss him. In Chicago, there were always plenty of more mobsters to choose as targets, but none like Hump." That's quite a remarkable, almost incredible tribute. Humphreys only visited Wales once, in the summer of 1963. On that occasion, he visited his father's home in Montgomeryshire, taking his first wife Clemmie and daughter Luella with him. During the visit, he apparently met four distant relatives, all tenant farmers of land Humphreys owned. He suggested they buy their farms, but they couldn't raise the funds. 2 months later, they were handed the freeholds of the farms. Humphreys, working at arm's length through a solicitor, handed over the farms for free, without saying a word. Humphreys and his wife Clemmie had a small ranch in Oklahoma, which I visited on one occasion. I learnt that his generosity was legendary. Every Christmas he would fill his pickup truck with dead turkeys and personally hand them out to poor people around Oklahoma City. He always carried a pocketful of silver dollars to give to anyone he met who was down on their luck. He also carried $10,000 in rolled banknotes just in case he met an awkward policeman. Murray Humphreys died in November 1965, aged 66. He was an enigma in his life and also in his death. On that day, FBI agent had called at Humphreys' flat in Chicago to arrest him for contempt of court, a puny charge, as Romer himself admitted. Humphreys, uncharacteristically, refused to open the door. When the agents threatened to break it down, it opened with Humphreys brandishing a gun. His behavior was very different to his usual polite manner, as if he didn't believe that they were FBI agents. Perhaps he was expecting someone else. The agents could have shot him there and then for pulling a gun on officers doing their duty, but they simply overpowered him, got the gun off him, and took him down to the police station, where he was charged with contempt of court and released on a bail of $100,000. By then, he had regained his composure, made a pass at a rather smart woman reporter, and went home. That evening, his brother Ernest called by the flat and found him dead on the floor while hoovering the carpet. The post-mortem stated that he had died from a heart attack, but another report mentions that there was a small hole behind his ear, consistent with an injection needle, and there's been speculation that he had been injected with air into his bloodstream, which could cause the same effects as a heart attack. In his death, as in his life, there were many unanswered questions. His body was immediately embalmed, avoiding further scrutiny. It's perhaps appropriate to note the date of his death, the 23rd of November, 1965, 2 years to the day after President Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas. No doubt this was just a coincidence, but it does lead to the most troubling unanswered question about Murray Humphreys. Did he have any knowledge of or involvement in the murder of John Kennedy? What happened in Dallas in 1963 is still a subject of intense speculation. No one has established the definitive truth, and perhaps never will. I would dearly like to believe that Humphreys had no knowledge whatever about the shooting. Sadly, that's not possible. While it's clear that Humphreys had no direct involvement in the murder, a number of factors suggest that he may have known in advance about the plot to kill the president. One indicator was a remark by Humphreys' second wife, Jean, shortly before she died in 2001. This is mentioned by Gus Russo in his book, Brothers in Arms, which deals with the Kennedy assassination. Jean had been told by Murray Humphreys, before the president's killing, that Mooney, that's Sam Giancana, Mooney is going to get even with Kennedy. Now that's quite significant, if indeed she was a reliable witness. But in itself, it proves nothing. Three questions arise in assessing whether Humphreys knew in advance about a conspiracy to kill Kennedy. Firstly, was there indeed a conspiracy? By now, the claim that Oswald acted alone in shooting Kennedy, the official American version to this day, looks totally incredible. Two factors reinforce the possibility of a conspiracy: that several bullets were fired from different angles, and secondly, that Jack Ruby shot Oswald before he could answer any questions. If there was a conspiracy, was the mob involved? They certainly had an axe to grind, and the motivation, which can't be dismissed. The mob helped ensure that John Kennedy got more votes than Nixon in Chicago in the 1960 presidential election. Chicago votes swung Illinois, and Illinois tipped the national outcome. The mob reputedly helped destroy evidence that John Kennedy was already married to Drury Malcolm when he married Jacqueline. The mob also helped Kennedy with the Bay of Pigs fiasco in Cuba in 1961. Their reward for helping the Kennedys in these various ways was an orchestrated White House crusade against them. They had good cause to feel very, very bitter. So thirdly, was there any evidence of mob links to the Dallas conspiracy? In his 1981 book, The Plot to Kill the President, Robert Blakey, chief legal advisor to the House Committee on Assassinations, stated explicitly that Carlos Marcello, Santo Trafficante, and Chicago outfit boss Sam Giancana were complicit in planning the assassination. Sam Giancana was assassinated days before he was due to give evidence to the Church Committee investigating collusion between the CIA and the Mafia. Another Chicago mobster, Johnny Rosselli, was due to give a second round of evidence to the Church Committee about a possible conspiracy to kill President Kennedy when he himself was murdered. So fourthly, did such links come anywhere close to implicating Murray Humphreys? Again, the evidence is circumstantial. Jimmy Hoffa was appointed Teamsters leader after Humphreys intervened. Hoffa disappeared mysteriously in 1975. Marcello was very close to Sam Giancana, and John Morgan describes Giancana as a Murray Humphreys prodigy. Johnny Rosselli was one of Humphreys' closest associates in corrupting Hollywood and establishing Las Vegas. The assassination pattern, the killer himself then being shot, was similar to the killing of Mayor Chermak of Chicago in 1933. John Morgan alleges that Murray Humphreys hatched the plot to kill Mayor Chermak. And Jack Ruby, who shot Lee Harvey Oswald, was for a period employed by one of Murray Humphreys' companies. Now, of course, none of this is conclusive, but a grain of doubt remains about Humphreys' awareness of a plot, and I'd be much happier if that wasn't the case. And let's not forget that Humphreys never forgave Joe Kennedy for going back on his word back in the 1920s. There also remains a mystery about Humphreys' death. If he was killed, Who wanted him eliminated, and why? Many of those who raised questions about Kennedy's death were themselves assassinated. Did Humphreys know too much, and did he pay the price? In conclusion, what was it that propelled Humphreys, despite his immense abilities, to become a key part of the world's largest system of organized crime? To understand this, I tried to find FBI agent William Romer, but he'd died. I did, however, contact a fellow agent who worked with Romer in Chicago. He told me that it isn't easy, perhaps that it isn't even appropriate for us in this age to pass judgment on someone like Murray Humphreys, who was, he said, the product of his own age and circumstances, and followed the path of so many other boys in Chicago in that unfortunate period. Okay, but most poor youngsters in Chicago withstood the temptation to be gangsters. Is it nature or nurture that determines such outcomes? Is it genes or environment that makes us what we are? Thank you for listening to this saga of the Welshman Humphreys, who, in his own incredible way, helped make America what it is today.